So let us begin with a new chapter. The new chapter is probability. Probability. Now, just to quickly recap, this chapter is not a new chapter because you have done this in class 11th also. In 11th, what did you do? Let me just quickly tell you. In 11th, you primarily covered two major aspects. One was the use of P and C in finding the number of favorable events and your sample space, correct? And using that, you can find your probability of the event. This is what you learned, correct? Second thing primarily you learned was the addition theorems. So what is PA union B, etc.? What is PA complement intersection B, PA intersection B complement? All those things you learned in the addition theorem. It's not that we are not going to use it anymore. These concepts will be still carried forward because while you're solving questions, you'll be again using them. And one more interesting thing that we did, I don't know how many of you remember, geometrical probability. Remember when there was a continuous sample space, you learned how to find out the probability of an event for that kind of scenario also. So that is actually called continuous probability or geometrical probability. So in class, So in class 12, what are we going to study? In class 12, we are going to study the following, okay? We are going to focus upon independent events. So out of all the events that we studied in class 11th, we are going to talk about independent events. Okay, we are going to take up some problems directly on that. Then we are going to talk about conditional probability. Conditional probability. So calculating the probability under a certain condition. Okay, so when we know certain part of the events, how do we calculate the probability of a subsequent event because of that? And conditional probability will be studied along with multiplication theorem. So multiplication theorem and conditional probability go hand in hand because you derive the result of conditional probability through the use of multiplication theorem only. Then we are going to talk about law of total probability. Let me write it down. Law of total probability. And finally, we are going to talk about the elephant in this chapter, which is the Bayes theorem. Bayes theorem is actually a conditional probability, but it uses this guy also. Okay, so it's a conditional probability where there is a use of total probability, and that is why this particular concept is very widely asked both in JEE exam and in your board exam, because it uses all the concepts that you have studied in this particular chapter, mostly all the concepts. Yes, Bayes theorem is also called as the reverse probability. Reverse probability. And finally, we are going to wrap this chapter with PDF. PDF. What is PDF? Probability distribution function. Probability distribution function, PDF. Okay. Normally, we only deal with one PDF, which is your binomial PDF. But I'll also talk about Poisson's PDF if time permits. But Poisson is not that important. I've never seen questions coming on it. I don't know why some of the books mention about it. So we're going to talk about binomial PDF. And we'll talk about Poisson's PDF. And to give you an insight about what is going to be in future coming from this chapter. So when you go to your engineering colleges, you will have a chapter called, you will have a course called Probability and Statistics, where you'll talk more about PDFs only. So there'll be different types of PDF, rectangular PDF, Langrange's PDF, a lot of PDFs will come to you. Okay, so this is the course content for us in class 12th. So we are going to start with independent events. So let's get started. Some of the brave hearts have joined despite having exam today. Well done, guys. Proud of you. Okay, so independent events. Independent events. So what is the definition of a compound event consisting of independent events? So we say two or more events are independent if occurrence slash non-occurrence of any one of them does not affect the probability of occurrence slash non-occurrence of the other. Okay. Some typical examples we can give here, like let's say there's a bag. Okay. Let's say this bag contains two red and three blue balls. Okay. Two red and three blue balls. Now you are drawing two balls one by one with replacement. Okay. So two balls are drawn one by one with replacement. With replacement means you have picked up a ball, you probably note down its color or something, and then put it back, and then again you pick another ball. Okay, like that. What is the probability that the second ball is a blue ball? What will the answer be? 3/5, correct? Does it depend upon what was the first ball? Correct? It doesn't depend what was the first ball. So the answer will be 3/5. Yes or no? Right? So this event A and B here, where A is picking up one ball, B is picking up another ball. Okay? They are both independent of each other because of this replacement factor. Because you replace them, they became independent. Right? So here they are example of, this is an example of an independent events. Okay. But on the same hand, if I change the question slightly and I say two balls are drawn one by one without replacement, what is the probability that the second ball is a blue ball? Now here you will have to see what was the first ball drawn. Correct? So that would come under the concept of conditional probability. Or for that matter, if I ask you, given that the first ball was a red ball, what is the probability that the second ball is a blue ball? That would come under conditional probability. Because your second event will now depend on the first because you are drawing the balls without replacement. Is this clear? Okay. So in the language of probability, we say that events A and B are independent, provided they satisfy this condition, PA intersection B is PA into PB. Okay. So for example, let's say another case I can give you. What is the probability of you getting a head on tossing a coin and a 6 on rolling a die? Your answer will be simply 1/2 into 1/6. Because both are basically independent of each other. Getting a head doesn't influence getting a six. Getting a six doesn't influence getting a head. Okay. And this can be extended further. So you can extend it further. So in general, I can say, if events A1, A2, etc. till AN are independent, then the probability of this compound event to happen, that is A1 intersection A2 all the way till AN, will be just the product of probability of occurrence of AI. Okay. Now, few properties that we need to look into when we are studying independent events. Let us first look into that before going to a question. Yeah, any query on whatever we have, whatever has been done so far? Oh yes, again Lagrange's. Yeah, so properties of independent events. Properties of independent events. The first property is, if A and B are independent, if A and B are independent, then number one, A and B complement will also be independent. Let me write it like this. Okay. And needless to say, A complement and B will also be independent. Okay. And A complement and B complement, they will also be independent. So some direct questions can be framed on this, not in JEE probably, but in some regional entrance exam. Most of you would be writing at least 3-4 exams minimum, right? So let's say you're writing your VIT exam and this question came. Okay. So how can we prove it? See, if you're claiming that A and B are independent, let me just prove one of them. Which one you want me to prove? I will not prove all of them. Which one you want me to prove? Let's prove the third one. Third one seems to be more robust. See, if you want to prove that these two events are independent, we need to prove that PA complement intersection B complement is PA complement into PB complement. Then only this event will be independent, right? Because we have learned that if any event, two event A and B are independent, PA intersection B or PX intersection Y should be PX into PY. Okay. Now, let us start with our left hand side. What is PA complement intersection B complement? In your childhood days, you have learned something called the Morgan's law, correct? De Morgan's law. Okay. So this is your De Morgan's law, which means it is 1 minus PA union B. Correct. Now you had learned addition theorems in your class 11th, where we had learned that PA union B is PA plus PB minus PA intersection B. Correct. So, if you open the brackets, we end up getting this. And also note that A and B are independent events. Since A and B are independent events, you can write PA intersection B as PA into PB. Okay. This is because A and B are, this is because A and B are independent events. Because they're independent events. Right? Now, if you factorize this, 1 minus PA, take minus PB common, again 1 minus PA. So you can get 1 minus PA times 1 minus PB. And this is clearly PA complement into PB complement. PA complement into PB complement. This is your right hand side and hence proved. Similarly, you can prove the first and the second as well. I think this was the heavier of the three. So I proved it. Similarly, you can prove your second and the third one. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns?
Could you scroll down?
Oh my God, Dhyan, what happened to your voice? It's echoing. Okay. Let me know once you're done. Done. Okay. Next is the complementation rule. Next is the complementation rule. complementation rule. So this says that if A and B are independent, if A and B are independent, then PA union B is nothing but 1 minus PA complement B complement. Okay, this is very easy to prove. All we can do is write PA union B as PA in A union B complement minus 1. Correct? Okay, and you can apply Murgan's law here, shotgun Murgan. Okay, and then you can use the fact that if A and B are independent, so will be A complement and B complement, and there you go. Okay, now a question may arise, is this rule extendable? Yes, it is extendable. So in general, we can say that if A1, A2, etc. till AN are independent events, so they will follow the complementation rule. So complementation rule means P of A1 union A2 till AN will be 1 minus P A1 complement, P A2 complement, P AN complement. Okay. Not a very important rule, but yes, it is a byproduct of whatever you have learned in the first property. So you can keep this in mind in case it is required. Now we'll take a few questions.
Sir, could you go up slightly?
Go up slightly here.
Yeah, thank you, sir. 1 minute.
This is all I've written on the page. Yeah. For the reason A and B are independent. Now, many people, when they're asked to check whether two events are independent, they try to check it from, you can say, non-mathematical point of view. Oh, this is affecting this, this is not affecting it. So don't go into that. Apply mathematics. Sometimes it may seem that the events are independent, but they may be dependent. Okay. So use the property PA union B, PA intersection B is PA into PB to verify it. Don't go like intuitively it seems, sir, it is independent, or intuitively it seems dependent. Don't do that.
Is that like?
I don't remember the examples exactly, but I have seen people see many a times PA and PB would be values will be such that they will speak volumes about it. Okay.
Okay, sir.
When you find PA intersection B, you may realize that it is not equal to PA into PB. We'll take questions. In fact, we'll have questions based on that. Don't worry about it.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Questions. So let's take, I'll start with a simpler one. Yeah, let's start with this question. Let A and B be two events. PA is 0.4, PB is P. PA union B is 0.7. Then find the value of P for which A and B will be independent. A very simple question. I'll put the poll on. Very good. All of you have voted for the same option. Very good. Okay. I'll close the poll in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Very easy question. Everybody should have got it right. Most of you have voted for C, C for Chennai. Let's check what is the answer for this. So PA union B is 0.7. This should be equal to PA, which is 0.4. Let me write it down directly. 0.4. PB is P minus P. A into PB because PA intersection B will be PA into PB because the events are given to be independent. Okay. Don't assume PA intersection B to be always PA into PB. It is only when they have mentioned that they are independent, you can write it like that. Okay. So this clearly gives you 0.3 is equal to 0.6 P. So P has to be half. Option number C is correct. Is it fine? Okay. Now let's take a question here. A bag contains four tickets. A bag contains four tickets. Okay. These tickets have numbers 112, 121, 211, 222. One ticket is drawn at random from the bag. One ticket is drawn from the bag. Okay. Let EI, I equal to 1, 2, 3, denote the event that the ith digit on the ticket is 2, then which of the following options are correct? So multiple options may be correct. E1 and E2 are independent. Okay. Option B, E2 and E3 are independent. Option C, E3 and E1 are independent. And option D, E1, E2, E3, all of them are independent. Okay. Multiple options may be correct. So please put your response on the chat box. So I'm not running any poll for this. Now, Venkat, reading at this, will you be able to comment which events are independent, which are not?
No, sir.
It is very difficult to predict in that way. Many people, they just read the question and they try to reason it out that it doesn't look like independent. It doesn't look like dependent. So don't do that mistake. Let's go from a mathematical and logical point of view rather than from our intuitions.
Got it, sir.
Very easy question. I mean, you can, yeah, multiple option correct, Aditya. Shisti, no. Amala, you will get part marks. But Shisti, you will get negative marks because you have marked an option which is not correct. I mean, subject to solving it, I'm commenting from the options I see in the answer key. So all of you know how to join the crash course session, right? So I don't have to send any kind of instruction. All of you have already experienced almost 3-4 classes. Very good, Pratham. Correct, Aditya. Correct, Tripan. Okay, guys, let's discuss this. Yes, Shristi. The answer here that the book says is A, B, C only. Now, let us check. So, first of all, let us write down even event. In how many ways can you get the first number as a 2? So, only one case is there. Two cases are there. 2, 1, 1 and 2, 2, 2. Correct? So, the probability of E1 will be 2 by 4 or you can say half. E2 will be what? E2 is second number is 2. So, I think it is 1 to 1 only and 2 to 2 only. This is also 2 by 4, 1 by 2. E1 and E2. What is E1 and E2? Means both the first digit and the second digit should be 2. Okay. So, that is only happening in the 2 to 2 case. So, only one event will be there under this set. Okay. So, this probability will be 1 by 4 because there are 4 numbers, 1 by 4. So, can we check now? Is this condition getting satisfied? PE1 intersection E2 is PE1 into PE2? Yes, very much. Because 1 fourth is equal to half into half. So, option number A is definitely correct. Okay. Similarly, let us figure out E2 and E3. E3, let me write it down because not take much time. E3 will only contain, I think, 2, 2, 2 and 1, 1, 2. So, that's also 1 by 2 only. PE3 is also 1 by 2. Okay. So, I think this will also be correct. Because E2 intersection E3 will only have 2, 2, 2. Correct? E3 and E1, they will only have again 2, 2, 2. So, again, this is also correct. But are all of them independent of each other? That is slightly doubtful because PE1 intersection E2 intersection E3 is 1/4, which is not matching with half into half into half. So this option is not correct. A, B, C only are correct. Okay. Can I move on to the next question? Sorry if I'm going a little fast because today is our last class and we have to cover a lot of ground. La 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 la. Okay, there are some questions which are based on your understanding of. Okay, let's take this one. Let's see, Venkat, if it is required. A license plate is 3 capital letters followed by 3 digits. If all possible license plates are equally likely, the probability that a plate has either a letter palindrome or a digit palindrome or both. Now, when I say digit, you can have 0 also coming in the first place. Don't worry about it. So, we can have a number of a car as CAT025. Okay. So, in number plates, we can have the first number as 0 also. Doesn't matter. Because it's just symbolic. It is just symbolic. Letter palindrome. Palindrome, everybody knows. What's a palindrome? Palindrome means if you read it from left to right or right to left, they will be read as the same thing. Let's have the poll on. Good, good, good. Let's close this in another 30 seconds. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Not many people have voted, but yeah, most of you have gone with A and B options. So A and B have got equal number of votes. Okay, let's check. See, first let us define the events. Let A be the number of cases where you get a letter palindrome. Okay, and B is the event where you end up getting the digit palindrome. Okay, so what do we have to find out? We have to find out PA union B, right? Okay, now one thing I can observe here is that the two events are independent of each other, correct? So can I not write this as this? Basically, I'm using my law of, or you can say complementation rule. Complementation rule. Okay. Now, PA. So in order to find PA, we have to find NA by NS. Let us find NS first. So how many number plates can be made? First of all, that is the question. How many number plates can be made?
So 26 cube into 10 cube.
See, when you're trying to find out the total number of ways in which you can make a letter palindrome, right? So why are we counting how many ways we can put numbers? Won't it be just 26 cube?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So what is the probability that when you make a 26 cube combination with these three letters, you'll end up getting a letter palindrome? So NA would be nothing but, see, in letter palindrome, whatever you choose here, that will automatically come in the last place. So you don't have any option for the last place. And this can also be chosen in 26 ways. So letter palindrome, the number of ways to choose is 26 square. So PA would be 1 by 26. Okay. Now, same for PB also we'll do NB by NS. You should call it as SNS dash probably. Or you can say, yeah, S dash. So in this case, S dash, NS dash would be 10 cube because 10 numbers can come in any of the three places. And out of which I want palindromes to come. So again, palindrome can come in 10 way, 1 way, 10 way. That means 100 ways or 10 to the power 2. So PB would be nothing but 1 by 10. Okay. So now the answer that I would get is PA intersection B will be 1 minus PA complement, which is 25 by 26 into PB complement 9 by 10. Okay. A lot of things can be simplified, I guess, 2 and this is 5. So 1 minus 45 by 52 will give you 7 by 52, which is option number option number A. Okay, I understood, Tripan. If you're doing that, that means you are taking into consideration two cases. You're taking care of the entire six digits simultaneously.
Yes, so yeah. It'll be the same only. Sir, same answer. Even in NA, then 10
cube. Okay. Because the extra three zeros will get cancelled because for the letter palindrome, you can have 10 to the power 3 combination, and same with the digit palindrome. Sir, yes. Even both are possible, right? We're considering that also. Yeah. Yes, Siddhartha. Both are also considered under the same thing. Don't worry. Okay. Let's move on to the next question. Let's take this one. If all the mappings that can be defined from set A to set B, a mapping is selected randomly, what is the chance? The word here is chance, not change. Chance. What is the chance that the selected mapping is strictly monotonic? Option is on. Not exactly to do with whatever we have done. It is just a testing of your normal probability skills. Poll is on, so please respond on the poll. Last 30 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Okay. Most of you have gone with option number B. B for Bengaluru. See guys, first of all, when a function is monotonic, it could be strictly increasing. Or it could be strictly decreasing. Okay. Now, if you have to make a function which is strictly increasing, remember, you have to have, first of all, one-one mapping. Okay. So, let's say one maps to something, two maps to something, three maps to something, and four maps to something. In other words, you have to pick up four such numbers from here And there's only one way in which you can arrange them in an ascending order, because one will map to the least, two will map to the slightly greater than that, three will map to slightly greater than that, and four will map slightly greater than that. So what is trying to say that F1 should be lesser than F2, should be lesser than F3, should be lesser than F4 in order to have a strictly increasing function. Correct? This is for your strictly increasing function. Right? In other words, whatever number you choose, whatever four numbers you choose, there's only one way to arrange them in a ascending order. Let's say if you choose 6, 7, 8, 9. So there's only one way. 6 can go to 1, or 6 can map to 1, 7 can map to 2, 8 can map to 3, and 9 can map to 4. If you choose 5, 7, 8, 9, 5 will map to 1, 7 will map to 2, 8 will map to 3, 9 will map to 4. Correct? So out of five numbers, you can choose any four of them in 5C4 way. Can I say same will be true if you're looking at strictly decreasing function? So whatever four numbers you choose and map to 1, 2, 3, 4, they can be arranged only in one way in descending order. So that is also 5C4. So total number of ways is 5C4 plus 5C4. Okay. And what is the sample space? Sample space is the total number of functions you can form. Total number of functions that you can form between set A and set B is your number of elements in the codomain to the power of number of elements in the domain. We had done this concept in our functions discussion, correct? Codomain to the power of domain. So 5 to the power 4. So this will be your answer. So answer is 10 by 5 to the power 4. 5 to the power 4, I can write like this. So this is 2 by 5 cube. 5 cube is 125. Option numbers B is correct. Got it? Clear? Okay. Let's take more question. These are all warm-up question, guys. Easy. This is what I hate, searching for the right question. This we have done. Okay, let's take this one. This is touch and go, guys. Touch and go. I think if I put the poll, you should be giving me the answer within 20 seconds. The probability of happening of three independent events are P1, P2, P3. Find the probability of happening at least one of them. Guys, let's close this in another 15 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay. After all, I mean, most of you have given the vote to the right option, but most of you have made mistakes also. See, guys, this is law of complementation or complementation rule. What did I discuss with you? If A, B, C, etc. are independent events, we can use complementation rule. Okay, that's one shot done. So this is 1 minus. What is PA complement? If PA is P1, PA complement would be 1 minus P1, 1 minus P2, 1 minus P3. Which option is correct? Option D is correct. Is it clear? Any problem in understanding this? I don't know why you people made mistakes. Okay, next question. AIEEE 2005 question. Let me put the poll on. Good. So they're trying to test you on two fronts, mutually exclusive and independent. And of course, equally likely as well. Okay, let's close this in another 20 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Okay, most of you have voted with option number B. So guys, first let us understand the difference between these three. First of all, equally likely. When you say two events are equally likely, it means PA should be equal to PB. Okay, when you say they are mutually exclusive, it means PA intersection B must be zero. And of course, when you know it is independent, you know PA intersection B is PA into PB. Okay. Now let's try to figure out from this information what is PA and PB. First of all, since PA complement is 1/4, it means PA is 3/4. Okay. Second thing is PA union B will be 5/6. Okay. And we have been given that PA is 3/4. PB, I don't know. Minus PA intersection B is 1/4. That means 5/6 is half plus PB. So PB will be equal to 5/6 minus this. That is nothing but 5/6 minus 3/6, which is 2/6, which is 1/3. Okay. Now, is PA equal to PB? I do not think so. So they are not equally likely. Not equally likely. Second thing is PA intersection B is not zero, so they cannot be mutually exclusive. Correct? So cannot be mutually exclusive. Not equal to zero. That means not mutually exclusive. Now, are they independent? Let's check. So PA intersection B is 5 by 6. Is it equal to 3 fourth, which is PA, into 1 third? No, I don't think so. Have I calculated? Yeah. So more than one options will be correct in this case, I guess. How come they asked in the... No. Only one option can be correct because it is asked in the AIEEE paper. Oh, P intersection B is given to us 1/4. Sorry, not 5/6. I was wondering, none of the options will be correct. Yeah, into 1/3. Yes, it is equal. So they are independent. They are independent events. So let's check which option is correct. So mutually exclusive and independent, that cannot be correct. Independent but not equally likely, B is correct. Equally likely but not independent, incorrect. Equally likely and mutually exclusive, incorrect. So option number B only can be correct. So B is the right option. Okay. Let's have one more question and then we'll go to conditional probability. Question is, one second. So let's say A and B are two people who are participating independently in a shooting competition. So they shoot independently. So A and B shoot independently until each hits his target. Until each hits his target. Okay. The probability of A hitting the target, the probability of A hitting the target in at each shoot is 3/5. Okay. Probability of B hitting the target at each shoot is 5/7. At each shoot, not the whole event, at each shoot. So one shot that they take, the probability that A will hit is 3/5 and the probability that B will hit is 5/7. Okay. Then the probability that B will require more shots than A is, then the probability that B will require more shots than A is option A 5/21, option B 6/31, option C 7/41, option D nota. So I hope the question is clear. So A and B both are aiming at their respective targets. Okay. What are the and the game will continue until each hits the target. So both of them have to hit the target. It's not that who hits first. It is both of them have to hit their respective target. So what are the probability that B will require more shots to hit than A? What is on? Almost 1 minute gone. I'll give you 1.5 minutes more. Think about it, then answer. No need to be in a hurry. Last 30 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Now, just 11 of you have voted, but out of 11, 7 of you have voted for option B. Okay, let's check. See guys, this is actually two summations undergoing in this particular process. So let's say A takes R attempts to hit the target. R attempts to hit the target finally. Okay. That means B has to take more than R attempts to hit it. Okay. So here, can I say if A has taken R attempts, means he will first fail for R minus 1 and then he will hit it in the last of his R attempt. So R minus 1 attempts, he will fail. Remember, the moment he succeeds, he has to stop shooting. Okay. So he would have failed R minus 1 time. Then the Rth time he would have succeeded. So PA complement to the power R minus 1 into PA. And remember, B has to fail more than that. That means P complement R into PB. Okay, but when I say more, it need not be just one more than what A takes. It may be two more, three more, four more, five more, and so on. So can I say one thing? For each of this R attempts that A takes, there are following possibilities that B can take. He can fail for R, succeed in the R plus 1th. He can fail for R plus 1th, succeed in the R plus 2th. And this can go on and on for infinity. This will go on and on for infinity. And this whole thing we have to sum up for r equal to 1 to infinity, because you never know how many attempts will A take. Right? So there is an infinite summation going on, and whatever you get, there is an infinite summation going on there also. Are you getting my point? So let us put the values here. So P not taking or not hitting the target, the chance is 2 by 5. So it's 2 by 5 to the power of R minus 1. Okay. This is going to be 3 by 5. Now here we have a geometric progression whose first term is this. Whose first term is this. And the common ratio is P B complement. Okay. So first term is this, means we can write it as P B complement to the power of R. So B complement, how much will it be? B complement will be 2 by 7 to the power R into 5 by 7 by 1 minus PB complement. PB complement, 1 minus PB complement is PB only. So you can write 5 by 7 here also. Okay. So thankfully, this will get cancelled off. Okay. And you're left with this. Summation of 2 by 5 to the power of R minus 1. PA, you can put it outside. And PB complement, that is 2 by 7 to the power of R. Okay. And R equal to 1 to infinity. Again, this can be very easily be dealt with. You just bring the 2 by 5 to the power minus 1 outside. So minus 1 means reciprocal of that. So it will become 3 by 2. And then you have summation of 2 by 5 into 2 by 7 to the power of R going from 1 to R going from 1 to infinity. Okay, so this is going to give you 3 by 2. This is an infinite GP whose first term will be 4 by 35. Okay. And yeah, and common ratio is also 4 by 35. Correct? Anything I missed out, do let me know. So it's 3 by 2 into 4 by 35. And this will be 35 will go up and you'll have 31 down. Six by 31. So your answer will be your option number B. Well done. This was not a simple question, at least to solve. But well done, those who solved it. 11 of you, 7 of you got it right. Good. Okay. Yes, sir.
The two numbers, I didn't understand that part.
Which part?
Yes, sir. This one.
See, for every R attempt that A takes, B can take R plus 1, R plus 2, R plus 3, R plus 4, da-da-da-da-da till infinity.
Yes, sir. That I got. Down
one. R itself is changing, no? What if R is 1, B will take 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 till infinity. R is 2, B will take 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 till infinity. R is 3, B will take 4, 5. So like that, there is a summation here. And for everything, there is a summation going on.
Yes, sir. Okay.
So this is a GP. I use GP formula, infinite GP formula. And then whole thing is a GP.
Oh.
Got it?
Oh, yes, sir. Good. And sir, another doubt?
Yes, sir. Tell me.
What if just could we like take some 2-3 minutes more and think for what will happen if 3 shots are required and all?
3 shots are required means?
Like A and B have to shoot for 3 times each and then find the probability that B requires more shots than A.
So let's say A shoots in the first go, B will require 2 or 3 shots. If A takes 2 shots, B will require 3 shots. And if A takes 3 shots, then there is no chance because A himself have taken maximum number of shots.
No, sir. I meant each of them have infinite shots and until both of them hit the target thrice. Like A hits the target thrice and it need not be in a row. And then he stops and then B attempts to hit the target like once, then miss, then twice, then miss 100 times and then thrice like that.
Okay, so you are trying to say that A will hit the target 3 times and the total number of attempts that he has taken to complete that three attempts of hitting is more than that of B, right? Is less than that of B, right?
Anything, yes, sir. Okay.
Yeah. So in this case, what you have to do is, in this case, you have to first figure out, you have to apply binomial. That is, the first two shots that A has successfully taken can occur in any of the R shots that he has already taken before he finally shoots it. So R minus 1, C2, you have to, make it into the system and multiply it with PA square. That will undergo binomial process now. See, ho keh raha hai, I'll explain it to you. Let's say R attempts are taken by A to hit the target, right? That means in the Rth attempt, he must have taken his third shot. And in R minus 1, he should have taken the two other shots.
Yeah, among R minus 1, choose right. 2.
Right. So what will happen? The first guy over here will change to R minus 1, C2, PA square. And again, PA. Because in the Rth shot, he is again hitting it.
Oh.
Are you getting it?
Sir.
And he is failing in the remaining. So you'll have to do R minus... how many attempts he is failing? He is failing in R minus 3 attempts, right? So this figure will come in the first part here, where I've underlined it here, this part.
Yes, sir. Okay.
What's the point now?
Yes, sir.
Accordingly, you have to change your B also.
Oh, okay, sir.
Right? Yes. So B, you have to make him take R plus 1 attempt, write the figure, R plus 2 attempt, write the figure, and then apply a summation to infinity. So two summations will go.
Got it, sir.
All right. Now, with this, we are going to talk about conditional probability. Conditional probability, that is the main thing we are going to study in this chapter, conditional probability. Okay. Now, many people have a very wrong understanding about conditional probability. Conditional probability, just a second. Yeah, conditional probability, I'll just give you first some examples to connect to. See, let's say, I'll take a very funny example. If let's say two people are running the race, let's say Aditya Manjunath and Mr. X. Okay. They're running a race 100 meters. Right? What is the chance that Aditya will win the race?
How do you know that it's equally
likely? Pratham is saying zero, he'll not win the race. Sir, he's fat, sir, he'll not win the race. Hey, Aditya will kill me. Yeah, half-half, right? Yes or no? Correct? So this half chance.
How do you know it's equally likely? I know some Aditya might have superpowers or something.
Wait. As of now, when you don't know anything about it, there are equal chances of them winning it, right? Both are competitors, right? 50-50 chance.
Correct? Sir, but then still you have other factors.
I have not mentioned other factors right now. Now I will mention.
Oh. Okay.
Now Aditya is running with Mr. X, which happens to be Mr. Usain Bolt. So what is the chance of Aditya winning the race? You'll say zero. Definitely Usain Bolt will win because he is known to be the fastest person on the earth. Right? So now given the information about X, you change your answer, isn't it? This is what we are actually going to study under this concept. When you know a condition in that event, your answer is actually going to fluctuate. Okay. So an additional information is going to change your probability answer. Let me give you another example, which is not as funny as this. Let's say I told you there is a family which has got two children. Okay. Child one, child two, elder and the older. Oh, sorry, elder and the younger. What is the probability that both the children are girls? What is the probability that both the children are girls? What will you say? Both are girls. What will you say? 1/4, correct? Because there are four possible gender distribution. You can do boy, 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 girl, girl, boy, girl, girl. So out of that, both are girls will be one. And total number of cases were 4. So 1/4, correct. But if I ask you the same question in this way, find the probability that both are girls given I know the younger one is a girl, the younger child is a girl, right? Now your probability will increase because you know that there is an additional information discharged at you or given to you that the younger child is known to be a girl. So now your answer will become half because this child is a girl. So they can be boy, girl or girl, girl. So only two possibilities out of which one is the possibility that both are girls. So your answer has increased because of this information. Given this information, your answer has changed. It is no longer 1/4. Are you getting my point? So given that person X is Usain Bolt, the chances of Aditya winning becomes negligible unless until he has some superpower on that particular day. Correct. So this is what we are going to study. So I'm just explaining this in a very, very, you can say, layman terms, right? So let's try to discuss this in more formal sense. So when you have a compound event occurring, right? When you have a compound event occurring, when these two are not independent, A and B are not independent. What happened to my spelling? Are not independent. Okay. So when we write the expression for this, we can either have A occurring and then B occurring given A has occurred. Or we can have B occurring and then A occurring given B has occurred. Now this term that you see is no longer PB unless until they are independent. This is no longer PA unless until they are independent because it depends upon it. Basically, this is the given condition to you that A has occurred before it. So let's go back to our the bag example which I gave you. So there are two red balls, three blue balls. Okay. You are drawing two balls out of which, out of this without replacement. Without replacement. If I ask you what is the probability that the second ball is a blue given the first one is a red, then this answer will be no longer when you were trying to find out the probability of getting the second ball red. Probability of getting a getting the second ball blue if it was done with replacement. Correct. So here your answer will be, as you told, 3/5, but here the answer will be 3/4 because it will be now changing. So the first information given to you that the first ball was a red basically changed your mind or you influenced your probability of getting a blue ball in the second trial. Okay. So this will be basically what we'll be studying under conditional probability. So there will be something given to you about that event which will change your answer. Are you getting my point? So this thing that I have written in front of you in the very first line, this is what we call as multiplication theorem. So through multiplication theorem, I'm going to derive the expression for P B given A has occurred or P given A P A given B has occurred. By the way, this is pronounced as probability of occurrence of B given an information is given to you that A has occurred. Given that A has occurred, right? Now many people ask me, sir, is it PB by PA? It will be PB by PA, but provided B is a subset of A. B is an event which is subset of A. Else not. So please do not treat it like this every time unless B is a subset of A. I'm not denying that it cannot be PB by PA. It can be if B is a subset of A. Okay, because if you look at this formula, it tells you that PB by A would be let's divide PA to the other side. Of course, PA is not zero in this case. So if you divide by PA, PA is not a impossible event, so it is not equal to zero. You can see that this is the actual formula. And if B happens to be a subset of A, then PA intersection B will be PB only, isn't it? If B happens to be a proper subset or subset of A, then PA intersection B will be PB only, isn't it? Then in that case, it can become equal to this, the first formula over here. Else not. Are you getting my point? So this is the formula for the probability of occurrence of B given A has occurred. Okay. Similarly, you can write probability of occurrence of A given B has occurred is P A intersection B by PB. Of course, PB should not be zero. Okay. So we have written this in light of multiplication theorem. So what is multiplication theorem? I will write this theorem in general. So multiplication theorem states that if there is a compound event occurring, that means all these events A1, A2, A3, etc. are occurring together, you can write it as PA1 into PA2 given A1 has occurred, into PA3 given A1 and A2 have occurred, into PA4 by A1 intersection A2 intersection A3 has occurred, da 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 da, till you reach PAN given A1 and A2 and AN minus 1 has occurred. Okay, this is the more general version of the multiplication theorem. What I have taken is a very small case where there are only two events in that compound event. Is this clear? What is conditional probability? First of all, that is clear. How multiplication theorem is helping you to get the expression for conditional probability? That is also clear. And under what case can I write it like this? Because most of the people have a habit of writing it like this. So under what case we can write? When you know your B is a subset of A. Is that fine? And under what condition will PB by A will be PB when A and B are independent? Under what condition PA by B or PA given B has occurred is equal to PA when A and B are independent? Okay.
So what, sir, could you repeat that?
See, what I'm trying to say is PB given A has occurred is PB only when your A and B are independent.
Oh, yes, sir. Okay.
And of course, PA should not be zero. Okay. And same thing with PA by B also is equal to PA when A and B are independent. Is this fine?
Sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, Tripan.
Sir, can you repeat that multiplication theorem?
Yes. Multiplication theorem says that the probability of occurrence of this compound event A1 intersection A2 intersection A3 till AN is PA1. Now, again, you can start with anything you want. You can start with A2 also. And then whatever you choose, you have to write probability of occurrence of that given A2 has occurred. Da 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 da. Like that. See, it's just coming from our common sense. It is just coming from our common sense. See, if I say, what is the probability that you are drawing, let's say there are five white balls, three green balls. What is the probability that just a second, guys. Yeah, sorry. So now let's say if you're drawing, let's say three balls out of which one by one without replacement. So three balls are drawn one by one without replacement. Okay. What is the probability that the first ball is a white, second one is a black, and the third one again is a black? Right. So what will you do? First ball white, you will draw five by eight. Now second ball blue, black, you will draw given that the first one is a white. So now your white ball has become lesser, isn't it? So it will become, why am I writing green over here? Sorry. 3 black. Yeah. So this black will be 3 by 4. Because you know the first draw is a white. And again, this black would be, given that you have already drawn a white and a black, so you will be left with one less white, one less black. So 4 and 2 over here. So this will be 2 by, I think I made a mistake, 3 by 7. Yeah. It will be 2 by 6. Are you getting my point? Okay.
Yes, sir. Understood.
The simple thing is basically written in a complicated language like this. See, guys, everything comes from our common understanding, common sense understanding. We just complicate it through the use of mathematical formula. Let's take questions.
Yes, sir. So what did you write about that independent thingy, the first?
Where?
First. First. A and B are not independent, sir. They can be independent. So then it'll just become zero and stuff. And then you'll divide and become zero. Okay.
We can say A and B may not be independent. That is fine.
Oh, got it, sir. Thank you, sir.
Because then it'll become a special case, right?
Yes, sir.
So you can also say, see, what is the probability of you getting a 6 on a die, given that you got a head on the coin which was tossed along with it? In this case, even if you write probability of getting a 6, given the head has occurred, it is just probability of getting a 6.
Yeah. Oh, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, let's take this. Two dice are thrown. What is the probability that the sum of the numbers appearing on the two dice is 11, given 5 appears on the first die? So read this if as given. So you have been given an additional information about this experiment. Please put your response on the chat box. Okay. Now, my job is also to tell you how to present your answer in your school and semester exams or board exams. Don't solve any question in probability without defining an event. It's a very wrong practice I've seen among all the students. They just write a formula. They just write down the values. Okay. While it will not hurt you in your competitive exams, but it will hurt you badly in your board exams. So you'll always should start with let A be the event that the sum of the numbers is 11. Okay. B is the event that 5 appears in the first die. 5 appears in the first die. On the first die. Okay. So what are we finding here? We are finding the probability of A given B has occurred. Okay. Now, as per our multiplication theorem, we can write this as PA intersection B by PB. Correct? Yes or no? Now, what is the chance that both of them occur, that you get a sum of 11 also and you get a 5 on the first die also? That is only one way, right? When you're
36.
Yeah, 5 and 6 happens. So this is 1 upon 36. Total number of cases is 36. So 1 upon 36 cases will be you get a 5 on the first and the sum is 11. And how many ways can you get a 5 on the first? So if you fix this to 5, then this can change in 6 ways. So this will be 6 by 36. So your answer will be 1 by 6. Now through this example, I would like to highlight one more thing. For both these, the sample space is the same. So when people write it, they normally ask me, sir, can we just write it like this? Yes, you can write it like this because NS, NS will get cancelled from both numerator and denominator. So you can directly say one event will be where 5 and 6, first number is 5 and sum is 11. And 6 such cases where the first number is 5. So 1 by 6 is the answer. Now, let me ask you an additional question. If I change the question to what is the probability that the first is a 5 given that the sum is 11? What will be the answer? Now, I flipped it. What is the probability that the first is 5 given that the sum is 11? Come on, guys. Very easy.
Same only, no, sir.
How same?
Because the other should be 6. Maybe. I mean, I didn't apply formula and all. I'm just telling.
What is the probability that your first number is 5 given that you get a sum of 11? Sum of 11 may be also obtained if you don't have the first number as 5.
Oh, that matters. No,
correct, Ravi Kiran. Ravi Kiran has got the answer. Yeah, see. Numerator will not change. It will be B intersection A or A intersection B, whatever you call it, because it is commutative operation by NA. Now, how many ways can you get the first number as 5 and the sum as 11? That is only one way. And how many ways can you get the sum of 11 itself? Two ways only, 5, 6, 6, 5. I don't know any third way to get it. So answer is 1 by 2. Are you getting my point? So see how knowing one thing changes the other. Got the point? Is it clear? Does it make sense?
Sir, but if you tell that it's given that the first number is, in the first example, 5 is on the first die.
Yeah.
That means P of B should be 1 only, no, sir. Because it's pakka 5 only. Then pakka means 1 only, no, sir.
No, you can make that as your sample space. For example, you can make the events where A is pakka occurring as your sample space. So 5, 6, 6, 5 will be your sample space, out of which one event is where your A is also occurring, B is also occurring. So that will come as a first event. But you can't say it is a pakka event because the event itself is a bigger event.
But you're telling it's given, no, sir?
I never asked you what is the probability of you getting a sum of 11 given that you have got a sum of 11. Have I asked you that?
No, sir. I was talking about P of B only.
See, I said B has pakka happened. But
yes,
have
sir.
I okay. asked you the probability of B?
Oh, no. Okay. But you're asking in denominator, no, sir?
Arey, baba. How do I explain this in a simpler language? Let's say you have tossed a coin 3 times.
Okay, sir.
What is the probability that the last thing that the coin shows is a tail, given that the first one was a head? This is the type of questions we are trying to address. Because even if it is head, this can change its place, right?
Yes, sir.
Are you getting my point?
Okay.
So I'm asking you the similar type of question over here. Given that your sum is 11, what is the probability that you're getting a 5 on the first? So even if you know your sum is 11, there are two cases in which you can get 11. And out of it, one of them is where you get a 5. So it's half the chance.
So no, sir. I was talking about...
It helps you to reduce your sample size. But it doesn't make it the entire thing as one.
Oh, okay. This one I understood. P of B by A, I understood. I was talking about P of A by B.
What is the question there?
There only. You've given that 5 is already on the first die. Then why are we telling P of B is 6 by 36? That yellow 6 by 36 there. Yes, sir. Around. That one.
Again, this is a way of solving it. You can actually consider that this to be a sample space also. That is what this formula says. This becomes your sample space.
Then
you can treat in how many of those sample space have both occurred. That is also a way to solve it. This is coming from the formula perspective.
Oh, okay, sir. Okay.
Getting
so this is like telling P of B occurs in Chakti 2 die scenario. Just take 1 die and then see how much
yes.
pi occurs.
What you are trying to say is that you are making the cases where B occurs to be your sample space because you're saying only that is occurring.
Oh, okay.
That is basically taken care by the second formula.
Oh, got it, sir. Okay, nice. Got it, sir. Got it.
All right. So let us take first a few properties of conditional probability. Then we'll take more questions. The first property is probability of occurrence of A given the sample space has occurred is actually PA. Right? In this case, you would realize that since A is a subset of S, your formula will work. But anyways, I'll do it in a proper way. So PA by S is PA intersection S by PS. PA intersection S will be PA. So this is the one which I was talking about to you the other time. When you know A, B is a subset of A, then you can write it like this. Okay. Else not. Else this is what you should always write. If A comes to be a subset of S, then only it will become PA. And this is nothing but PA only because PS is anyways one. Not a very useful property, but note down just to maintain the exhaustiveness of the situation. But PS by A will be actually 1. Right? Why? Because PS by A or PS given A has occurred is PS intersection A by PA. And PS intersection A is PA only. So PA by PA will cancel each other out and you'll get a 1. Okay, S is the sample space. Let's take a few more useful ones. The probability of occurrence of A union B given C has occurred is given by probability of occurrence of A given C has occurred plus probability of occurrence of B given C has occurred minus probability of occurrence of A and B given C has occurred. How do we prove it? Let's look into this. So if you start with the left-hand side, probability of occurrence of A union B given C has occurred as per our multiplication theorem is probability of occurrence of C intersection A union B by PC. Correct? Now we can use our distribution of intersection over union. Correct? Now, treat this as X, treat this as Y, and you have written like PX union Y. We know our addition theorems, let us apply that. So, which is PX plus PY minus PC intersection A intersection C intersection B upon PC. Correct? So this is PC intersection A plus PC intersection B. Now, if you look at this term very carefully, you can write it actually like this. Okay. And if you individually divide, so let me individually divide each one by PC. What does this term represent? What does the first term represent? The first term represents P A given C has occurred. What does second term represent? It represents P B given C has occurred. And what does the third term represent? The third term represents P A intersection B given C has occurred. Hence proved. This is what you wanted to prove. Is that fine? Any questions, any concerns? Note down if you want to. Okay. The last property, the fourth property, let's take it over here. Fourth property is very useful. PA complement given B has occurred is just 1 minus PA given B has occurred. Now, what is the proof for this? Again, very simple. If you start with your left hand side, which is your probability of A complement given B has occurred, by the very definition or by the multiplication theorem, I can say this. Okay. And this is nothing but, now, if you remember your addition theorems, what is A complement in section B? This is the zone, right? A complement in section Z. Can I say it is actually PB minus PA intersection B? Correct? So the numerator part will be this. So if you divide by the denominator individually, it becomes this. Okay. And the second term is clearly PA given B has occurred, which is your right hand side. Can B in the complement? Okay, now very good question. So now Aditya is asking, what will happen to the formula if we are finding PA given B complement? So in this case, what you have to do, Aditya, follow the definition. Everything is coming from the definition. Okay. Now, this is nothing but, as per the addition theorem, this is PA minus B, which is PA minus PA intersection B. Okay. By PB. Sorry, B complement. So B complement is 1 minus, let me write it in the second step. So this is PA minus PA intersection B by 1 minus PB. This will be your formula. Got it, Aditya?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So only when your the top event is complemented, then only the previous formula can be used. Else you have to use this formula. Okay, let's take a question on this. Very simple question, just to test your basics. Poll is on. Done. Let's close this in another 10 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. There you go. Most of you have gone with option number A. Let's check option number A is correct or not. See, what has been given to us? PA has been given to us as 1/4. PB has been given to us as 1/10. And PA intersection B has been given to us as 1/10. Oh, my bad. 1/6 was correct. My mistake. Yeah, 1/6. So as per our multiplication theorem, this is PA intersection B or PB intersection A, whatever you want to write it. So this is going to be 1/6 upon PA. PA is 1/4. Is that fine? Oh, sorry. 1/10 upon 1/4. 1/10 upon 1/4. That's nothing but 2/5 option number A. Is that fine? Any questions? Next. Given PA is 0.3, PB is 0.4, PA complement intersection B complement is 0.5. Find PB given A union B complement. Zero. Okay, let's check. Okay. Okay, now see, everybody, please pay attention. So PB given A union B complement. Can I say it is PB intersection A union B complement by PA union B complement, correct? As per our distribution formula, this will be PA intersection B intersection A union B intersection B complement by this. Now, okay, now see here, this is a null event. Okay, so this will be nothing but PA intersection B. Correct? Now let us figure out these values. So what is P A intersection B? We can get it from here. This is nothing but P A union B complement, which is nothing but 1 minus P A union B. P A union B is P A P B minus P A intersection B. Correct? Yes or no? So 0.5 is 1 minus PA. PA is 0.3 minus 0.4 plus this factor, which is not known to us, which we'll figure out from here. Yeah. So this will give you 1.2, which is 0.2. So 0.2 will be your PA intersection B. So the numerator will be 0.2. What about denominator? We'll figure it out. Let's figure it out. PA union B complement. Can I write it as PA plus PB complement minus PA intersection B complement? Okay. This is nothing but PA. This is nothing but 1 minus PB. And this term is nothing but, as per our addition theorem, it is PA minus PA intersection B. If you open it up, if you open this up, PA, PA will get cancelled and you'll get up 1 minus PB plus PA intersection B, which is nothing but 1 minus 0.4 plus 0.2, which is 0.8. So denominator is 0.8. So your answer has to be 1 upon 4. Has anybody got 1 upon 4? Oh, Tripan got, Ayush got. Very good. Well done, guys. Well done. Good. Is it fine? Slightly lengthy problem, but everything was well within our understanding. Which part do you want me to do by Venn diagram?
So the A union B complement. I mean, that's effectively doing the entire thing.
See. A union B complement. B complement is the outside part.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Union the A, union that with A means outside only.
Yes. Right? Union with A means this part will also come into picture, no?
Oh, yes, sir. That's right. Got it. My bad. My real bad.
Next. Okay, I think we have, let's take this one. Easy question. I'm putting the poll on. Very good. Let's stop this in another 10 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, go. All right, I'm seeing C option coming from most of you, those who voted. Let's check. Yeah, so this is nothing but P. A complement intersection B complement by P B complement. And as per the De Morgan's law, this is P union B complement. And this is 1 minus PA union B upon PB complement. Option number C is correct. Is it fine? Let's take one word problem also. Three coins are tossed. If one of them shows tail, find the probability that all three coins show tail. Simple, very simple question. I'm not able to take a lot of questions on this because we have to wait till we do law of total probability. And in Bayes' theorem, again, we are going to deal with conditional probability because Bayes' theorem is actually a case of conditional probability. Done. So read this as given one of them shows tail, what is the probability that all show tail? I think it is at least one of them. This should be written as at least one of them. Yeah. So what are we trying to find out? We are trying to find out this. Okay. So as per our multiplication theorem, this is what we are going to write. You can write it as NA intersection B by NA. Right? So in how many ways can you get at least one of them showing a tail and all showing a tail? See, since all showing a tail is a subset of this, this is as good as NA. Sorry,
B and B.
Yeah, B is a subset of A. Sorry, not A. So all showing a tail is a subset of this. So it will be NB by NA. So in how many ways, can you get all of them show a tail? Only one way, tail. And in how many ways can you get at least one tail? Is just remove all the head scenario from 8 cases. So answer will be 1/7. Are you getting my point? So we'll come back again to more questions based on this. But before that, we have to learn something very important, which is called the law of total probability, because law of total probability is going to be one of the most important thing that we are going to use for such cases. Okay, so it is not that I'm finishing off this conditional probability. Conditional probability will be again revisited in our Bayes' theorem. Bayes' theorem is actually a conditional probability, but just to add more material to the concept, we have to use law. We have to deal with law of total probability. So, law of total probability. What is this law? This is actually a common sense thing, but written in a very, very, you can say, complicated fashion, like formula. See, I'll just ask you a simple question. Okay. There are three bags. Bag one, bag two, bag three. All of equal shapes and sizes. Bag one, bag two, bag three. This bag has got 5 green balls, 2 red balls, 3 green balls, 5 red balls, 1 green ball, 2 red ball. Okay. Now, you are a person who is blindfolded. Okay. So somebody has blindfolded you. You are like, which was that character in Mahabharata? Father of Duryodhan.
Gandhari. Blindfolded was Gandhari. Blind was the Dhritarashtra.
Oh, yeah. So you are like Gandhari. So yeah, you should be female. Okay. Right. So you go and you put your hand in one of the bags. You don't know which bag you are putting your hand. And you get a ball. Okay. What is the probability that Venkat the Gandhari will get a green ball? The way they made Ramayana, oh my God. Father is blind. Father cannot see. Mother knows it, but she has blinded herself against the, you know, faulty things of her son. Very cleverly written story, no? Symbolizing the present scenario.
Tushar, Tushar said about Mahabharata, he'll give you.
Arre bhabra, bhabra. If you want to enter into a 1 hour lesson with him, then only. He is very learned when it comes to all these things. Yes, so how will you solve this question? You don't need a formula to solve this question. What will you say? Okay, there are 3 cases in which I can end up getting a green ball. Okay. Achha, no, one small thing I would like to say. Why not the answer is total number of green balls divided by total balls? Why not the answer is 9 upon 7 plus 8 plus 3? Okay. First of all, anybody thinks this is the answer? 1 by 2? Because there are 9 green balls out of total 18 balls. Is this the answer? Yes, no, maybe. Okay, this cannot be the answer because this particular thing is derived from the fact that there is an equally likely chance of a ball being green and a red, right? So there's an equal homogeneous mixture that you have prepared out of it. But actually it is not. It is basically, since in the language of physics, I can say the potential is different in all the surfaces over here. Okay, so your chance of finding a charge when there is a sharp corner is more as compared to a blunt part of the object, isn't it? So when you divide it in this way, you are basically dividing the green balls into different potential zones. So potential of finding a green ball is high here. Potential of finding a green ball is less over here. Are you getting my point? So they are not equally distributed. Also, has to say that they are not homogeneously distributed. Are you getting my point? So how will you solve such a question? So you'll say, okay, let my hand go in bag number one. Now, given your hand has gone into bag number one, the chance itself that it'll go in bag number one is 1/3. And now that your hand is in bag number one, you coming out with a green ball will be 5/7. Correct? Or your hand goes in bag number two, whose chance itself is 1/3, and you And given that your hand is in bag number 2, the chance of you getting a green ball will be 3 by 8. Correct? Or your hand goes in bag number 3, whose probability itself is 1/3, and you putting your hand in bag number 3, getting a green ball will be again 1 by 3. Okay? So this is the total ways in which you can pick up a green ball, and that's why the name of the theorem comes as law of total probability. So this is the chance of you getting a green ball. Yes or no? Yes or no? So this is from a very common sense way that you figured out what is the chance or what is the probability of getting a green ball. Now the very same thing, I'll complicate it with a lot of mathematical jargons. So let us say, I'm generalizing these things. Let's say E1, E2, etc. are mutually exclusive and collectively exhaustive events. The word collectively is optional, you can drop it also, or exhaustive events. Okay. What is the meaning of mutually exclusive and collectively exhaustive, MEC? What is the meaning of that? It means that if you take any two of them, their intersection will be a disjoint set or a null set. Okay. So they will be disjoint sets. And their union will be your sample space. Okay. When such a thing happens, when both of these simultaneously are satisfied, then we normally say P, E1 union E2, etc. till EN will actually result just into P, E1 plus E2 plus E3 till P, EN. In other words, 1 will be equal to P, E1 plus E2 till Yeah. So any events which are mutually exclusive and collectively exhaustive will always satisfy this condition. Please note that. Okay. Now let me complete the theorem. The theorem is not completed. So let's say if E1, E2, EN are mutually exclusive and collectively exhaustive events, and let's say there is an event A, and there's an event A that occurs with these EI events, occurs with these EI events, okay? Then we say that probability of occurrence of A would be nothing but probability of occurrence of E1 into probability of occurrence of A given E1 has occurred, plus probability of occurrence of E2 into probability of occurrence of A given E2 has occurred, and so on till the last. Now, how does this formula come about? Let us try to understand through a simple Venn diagram. Let's say this is a sample space. Okay. And let's say E1, E2, E3 are your certain events which are disjoint like this. So this is your E1, this is your E2, this is your E3, this is your E4, da 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 da, till your EN. Okay. So they are disjoint, but yet they make the entire sample space. And let's say there's an event A which occurs along with these all events. So there's an intersection of A with these events. So this is your event A. Let me use yellow color. Okay. So what is the probability of occurrence of A? If you look at this diagram, it will be sum of this area, and so on till this area, correct? So the first area will be P E1 intersection A. Second area will be P E2 intersection A. Correct? And it goes on till P EN intersection A. Now, as per our multiplication theorem, we can write this as P E1 into P A given E1 has occurred. Similarly, this is P E2. Into P A given E2 has occurred, and da 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 till P N into P A given E N has occurred. Yes, this will be your P A. That is what formula I wrote over here. Is this fine? So if you compare this with our example which I gave you, then your E1, E2 were like picking up bag 1, bag 2, bag 3. So if you compare with this example, Okay, this example, this will become PE1. Given that you have picked bag number one, right? And the probability of getting a green ball given you have picked a bag number one will be your 5/7. Then this will be PE2. And this will be P getting a green ball given you have selected bag number two. Similarly, this is PE3 and getting a green ball given that you have selected bag number three. Are you getting my point? So what you wrote without knowing this formula is what this formula actually tells you. So there's nothing above logic. If you're solving it logically like this, you do not need to remember any kind of formula like this. Yes, this is just an eyewash which you have to use in your board exams just to get marks. Is this fine?
Sir, could you go down 1 second? Little left, sir. One thing. Thank you, sir. And sir, yeah, I put something on chat box. That also, can you read, sir, regarding this question?
Too lazy to tell it again.
1G, 3R, 39G, 117R, 59G, 177R. Can we directly go to the first case? Didn't understand anything.
Yes, sir. So I meant we eliminated the probability of 9/18 in the first method because they weren't equally likely. So in this case, we can do, sir. Everything is 1/4, 1/4.
1/4.
Yeah.
1/4. I didn't get 1/4.
In each bag, irrespective of the number of green balls, it's equally likely that we pick a green ball, no, sir?
In a bag, yes. In a bag per se.
Okay.
But the event is not just picking from one bag. It is picking up from any one of the three bags.
Yes, sir. But in this case, so the bags won't matter.
Density is changing. No, density is changing. Let's say if I say, what is the probability of you finding a Tamilian in Karnataka? And what is the probability of you finding Tamilian in Delhi? So here, you know that there will be more chances of getting a Tamilian because it is a neighboring state of Karnataka. So there's a chance that a Tamilian can come in Karnataka, right? But Delhi is like very remote. It's very less chance that a person will travel from, a hub of, IT hub of Bangalore and Karnataka to Delhi to get a job. But if you say, what is the probability of you getting a Tamilian from the entire country, then you'll basically do the total, if there was a homogeneous distribution, then you'll do total Tamilian people divided by total population.
Yes, sir.
But now your chance will change because your distribution of the people are different in different zones.
No, sir, your chance won't change. 39, everything is 1/3 only. 1/4, sorry.
You're saying that if there's one green and three red.
One green, three red. I could use bad numbers. No. Bag one is one green, three red. Bag two is 39117. I chose the wrong numbers. Very sorry. Uh-huh. And other bag is 59 and 177. It's anyway in each of the bag, green and green is 1/4.
Yeah, then it will be same. Then it will be same.
Then you can just add all red plus green and then add all green and divide.
Right. Then okay. It will be same. Yes.
Okay, sir. Got it, sir.
Next, we'll take some questions on this. Yeah, let me put the poll. Very simple question, guys. You should all get it. Three groups A, B, C are contesting for position of the board of directors of a company. The probability of their winning is 0.5, 0.3, 0.2. If A wins, probability of introducing a new product is 0.7. B wins 0.6, C wins 0.5 respectively. Find the probability that the new product will be introduced. Okay, most of you have gone with option C. Sorry, I'll not say which option. We'll stop in 10 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, go. All right. Most of you have gone with actually option A.
Knew it, sir.
I was trying to see how many of you marks see when I say that on purpose. Okay. First of all, you have to define it. So let even is the chance that group A wins the election. E2 is the chance that group B wins the election. And E3 is the chance that your group C wins the election. And A is the chance that your product, new product, whatever, is launched or introduced. Okay. So what is the chance that the new product will actually come? So probability of occurrence of A will be nothing but summation of probability of EI into PA given EI has occurred. So A winning, given A winning the product being launched, 0.7, correct? Or B winning, given B winning the product is launched, 0.6. C winning, given C winning the project is launched is 0.5. So this is 0.35, this is 0.18, and this is 0.10. That's nothing but 0.63. Option number A is correct. Very easy question. Is this fine? Any questions, any concerns? Okay, next question. Just listen to this question carefully. It's a lengthy question. Question is, suppose families always have 1, 2, or 3 children. Suppose families always have 1, 2, or 3 children. Okay. Oh, what I'm writing. 1, 2, or 3 children. Okay. One child, I should write, not children. 2 children, 3 children. Okay. So probability of the family having one child is 1/4. Probability having 2 children is half. And probability having 3 children is again 1/4. So there's more chance of having 2 children rather than 1 and 3. Okay. Suppose everyone eventually gets married and has children. Okay. Suppose everyone eventually marries and has children. Find the probability that a couple has exactly four grandchildren. Think carefully and then answer. Question is understood, right? So the chance that a family has one children is 1/4, 2 children is half, 3 children is 1/4. Okay. So let's say there was a couple. So I don't know how many children they had. And those children had children. So basically grandchildren. So how many way, what is the probability that that couple will have exactly 4 grandchildren? Good try, Amla, but that is not correct. Good try, Ravi, but not correct. That's correct, Pratham. Very good. Anybody else who would like to contribute?
Yes, sir. One second.
No Tripan, no Shisti. Okay, let's see this. Let's say there's a couple. Okay. If this couple has one child, then there is no way that he can actually give 4, or they can not have 4 grandchildren. Okay, correct. If this family has, let's say I take case one. If this family has 2 children, let's say this couple has 2 children. Let's say Chintu Mintu. Okay, then either Chintu has 1, Mintu has 3. Or Chintu has 3, Mintu has 1, or both have 2, 2. And then only this couple can have 4 grandchildren, right? So within this, we have these cases. Okay. Let me write it as small 1, small 2, small 3. Correct. The third case is, let's say this couple itself has 3 children. Let's say Chintu, Mintu, and Pintu. Okay. So what are the chances that they will have 4 children together? So this has 1, 1, 2, or various combinations of it. So you can have 1, 2, 1, or 1, 1, 2, whatever. Okay. Or any other way. No, 1, 1, 1 also cannot happen. 2, 2, 0 cannot happen. okay, because they have to have children. Okay.
2-1-1.
Uh-huh. That all combinations I'll take care of. Don't worry. Okay. So these are the cases in which the couple will have 4 grandchildren. So let's say if the couple had the total number of ways in which they have 4 grandchildren. 4 grandchildren would be either they have 2 children, Mintu and Pintu, whose chance itself is half, because any parent having 2 children or having set of parents having 2 children, chance is half. Okay. And then Chintu has 1, Mintu has 3, the chance will be 1/4 into 1/4. And there are 2 such cases like this, where Chintu has 3, Mintu has 1. Okay. And if they have 2-2, the chance is half square. Okay. So this is the probability that the couple will have 4 grandchildren, given that they have 2 children. So this is like your PE1. And this is like your P, let's say this event was A. So this is A/E1. Okay. Or this couple had 3 children, Chintu, Mintu, and Pintu. Then the chance that 2 of them have 2 children. Sorry, 2 of them have one child. Okay. And the other one has got. See, have I repeated anything? I think I've repeated this again. So 2 having 1/1 is 1/4 square, and other having 2 is half, and there are 3 such cases. Correct?
1/4.
So 1/4, 1/4, half, 1/4, 1/4. So they have written this 3 times. So this will be your total probability. So let's check how much does it come out to be. So this is half. I think this will come out to be 1/16 plus 1/8. So, oh, sorry, I have written. Yeah. Let me just write it properly. Yeah. So this is half of 1/8, 1/4. And this is 1/32. Okay. So this is half of 12/32. Have I missed out anything?
1/28, that means.
Wait, this is 1/4. Thank you.
So 3/120.
This also. Where is the eraser? Okay. So this will be 6, that is 24/128 plus 3/128. Answer is 27/128. This is your answer. Is this fine? Any questions? All right. So there are enough questions we can take on law of total probability, but I would like to introduce to you very quickly Bayes' theorem, because time is running out. Bayes' theorem. Bayes' theorem is also called reverse probability, because when you read the question of a Bayes' theorem, you would get a feeling that you are going in a backward direction to calculate something. Okay. So let's go back to our old question where we had those bags and balls inside it. So let me just give you the same scenario. So there are 3 bags of equal sizes, bag 1, bag 2, bag 3. Again, 5 red, 6 green, some random numbers I'm taking, 3 red, 4 green, 2 red, 1 green. Okay. Now, again, you are going and picking up a ball from this bag, and again, you are, let's say, blindfolded. Okay. You pick up a ball you found that ball is green, what is the probability it came from bag number two? Right? So what I'm trying to find out, I'm trying to find out that given your ball is green, what is the probability that it came from bag number two? As you can see, the look and feel or the wording of the question will suggest that you know the final result, and then you are going to check which of the MEC event was associated with that event. Which of those MEC events was associated with that event, right? So this is what we call as the Bayes theorem. Now, ultimately, what is this? This is a conditional probability only, right? So you will say, as per the conditional probability formula or as per the multiplication theorem formula, this is going to be this, correct? Your numerator is just going to be probability of picking bag two and probability of getting a green ball given you have picked bag two. And your denominator will be the total number of ways in which you are picking up the green ball, right? So PBI into PG given BI has occurred, I will go from 1 to 3, isn't it? So what is happening? See, in a nutshell, you are using conditional probability. So Bayes theorem is nothing but conditional probability, nothing else. But what is happening in addition to conditional probability? In one of the unknowns that you're trying to find out, denominator, you are using LTP, law of total probability. And numerator is nothing but the use of multiplication theorem. Of course, the whole thing is coming from multiplication theorem only. So as you can see, this concept incorporates all the subtopics that you have already studied so far. Multiplication theorem, conditional probability, LTP, and of course, we are studying it under Bayes theorem, right? So when you are trying to find out any such questions, you just calculate the law of total probability first. For example, if I have to solve this question, I will first calculate in how many ways can I get a green ball. So 1/3, 6/11, 1/3, 4/7, 1/3, 1/3. Correct? Yes. So this will sit in my denominator. And what will sit on the numerator is where I have got my green ball from the bag number two. So this will sit on the numerator. So your answer for this question will be 1/3 into 4/7 upon this whole expression that you've written. That is 1/3 6/11, 1/3 4/7, 1/3 1/3. Are you getting my point? Is it clear? So I've just explained it from a simple example. If you remember this example, all Bayes theorem question, you will find it very, very easy. Is this understood? Okay. Now there are certain terms that we normally use for this. Your E1, E2, etc., which is basically, okay, let me just give you the theorem first and then I'll name it. So is this example making sense to you? Does this example make sense to you?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So when you talk about things in general, again, let's say you have E1, E2, etc. as your mutually exclusive and collectively exhaustive events. Okay. And if you're trying to find out probability of occurrence of, okay, let me just write A also. And A occurs with your EIs. Okay. And if you know that A has occurred, what is the probability that it came because of some EK event? Then Bayes theorem says that it is PEK into PA/EK by summation of PEI into PA/EI, I from 1 to N. In short, your denominator is coming from your law of total probability. Okay, and whole thing is coming from conditional probability. Are you getting my point? By the way, there are certain terms that we normally use. PA, E1, E2, etc. You can say PEIs. This is actually called as priori probabilities. Nothing in the name, just you should know. Okay. And PEI given A has occurred is actually called posteriori probabilities. Today my spelling is probabilities. Okay, just a name that is given to it. So this is one of your posteriori probability. Okay, and this probability of E1, E2, etc., they are called priori probabilities. Now, before we take a break, I would definitely like to take a question on this. Without the question, things will not be. Yeah. Let's take a question. Question is, I'll just make a question over here. Let's say there is a bag. Bag one, and there's another bag, bag two. Fine. This bag contains 3 red and 5 green balls. Okay. And this bag contains 5 red and 3 green balls. Fine. Okay. Two balls are transferred from bag number one to bag number two without noticing their color. Okay. Two balls are transferred from bag number one to bag number two without noticing their color. And again, two balls were drawn from bag number two. Okay. And they were found to be a red and a green. Okay. What is the probability that the two balls transferred from bag number one to bag number two was both red? Find the probability that the balls transferred from bag one to bag two were both red. Given that you got a red and a green from bag two after this transfer was done. This is what I am asking you.
Sir, here red, green, green, red, same thing only, sir.
Sorry?
Here red, green, green, red. In the last case, same only, sir.
Again, when you're drawing two balls, one of them is red, one of them is green. That's it.
Oh yeah, anyway, it doesn't matter.
Yeah. Okay, let's discuss this. See, here, what are your MEC events? Your MEC event could be, you could transfer both red balls from bag one to bag two. Correct? E2 could be, you can transfer one red and one green from bag one to bag two. E3 could be, you can transfer both green balls from bag one to bag two. So these are your MEC events, correct? Now MEC events, it is very easy to identify them by the use of the fact that the sum of their probability should come out to be one always. Please remember this. This is very important. If your MEC events are such that the sum of the probability is not coming out to be one, that means something is wrong in your working. And what is the event A? Event A is you get both red from bag two. Correct? Now, what did I tell you when I was discussing Bayes' theorem? So we are basically trying to find out, given A has occurred, what is the probability that both ball transferred were red in color, right? This is what we are finding out. So as per our Bayes' theorem, this is PE1 into PA by E1 by summation of PEI into PA by EI. Okay. But I normally do not proceed with a formula in mind. This is just for your school exam. What I do is plain and simple. My approach is very plain and simple. I first sit and find out in how many ways can I get two red balls from bag two. Right? Indirectly, I'm trying to find the denominator first. So I can get two red ball, sorry, I can get a red and a green ball from bag two. Oh, my bad. My event was not both red balls. Sorry. My event was, I'm so sorry. My event was getting a red and a green from bag two. Okay, sorry. So what do I do first? I'll first see how many ways can I get a red and a green from bag two. So if two reds were transferred, what is the probability first that two red will be transferred? So that will be 3C2 by 8C2. So two red out of three can be chosen in 3C2, right? And total eight balls were there. So eight by 8C2. And now that two red are transferred into this, the composition of red ball here will now become 7 and 3. Now from 7 and 3, you are picking up one red and one green. So 7 and 3, if you are picking one red and one green, the probability for that will be 7C1 into 3C1 by 10C2. Am I right? Okay. Or let us say I had transferred one red and one green to the other bag. So one red and one green, I can transfer it in 3C1, 5C1 upon 8C2 probability. And given that I have transferred one red and one green, the composition will change where it will become six red and four green. From six red and four green, the chance of me getting one red and one green will be 6C1, 4C1 by 10C2. Okay. Or I could end up transferring two green balls from bag number one to bag number two, whose chance itself will be 5C2 upon 8C2. And given that I have transferred two green balls, the composition will become 5-5 each. And then you getting one green ball and one red ball is 5C1 into 5C1 by 10C2. Okay. This will become your, the denominator term. Okay. So this will become your denominator term. So this guy is going to be nothing but your denominator term. Now out of this, one is going to sit on the numerator. Which of them is going to sit on the numerator where you had transferred both red balls? So the first guy is going to sit on the numerator. So the answer for the question that you're looking out will be 3C2 by 8C2 into 7C1, 3C1 by 10C2 whole divided by this whole lot. 3C2, 8C2, 7C1, 3C1, 10C2. We have to write so many things. Just copy paste this. Is there any questions, anybody, based on this? Now, I'm not calculating it for the in the interest of time. So please do so. And you can proceed from here on. This is your answer. Any questions? Any questions, any concerns? Is that fine? Any questions? Okay. Now you can take a break. You can take a break. A letter is known to have come either from Krishnagiri or Dharmapuri. On the postmark, only the two consecutive letters R and I are visible. What is the probability that it came from Krishnagiri? Let me put the poll on for this. Yeah, I know many people will mark that option, which somebody has already marked. Remember, the distribution of RI is not uniform. So it is not about seeing how many RIs are there and how many of them are present in which one of them. So it is slightly more complicated. There's one similar question that says London and Clifton. So they'll say the letter is supposed to either come from London or Clifton. And if only ON is visible on the two consecutive letters, ON is only visible on the envelope, what is the chance that it came from, let's say, London or Clifton? So that's a similar question. This is just an Indian version of the same thing. Another question was, I think, Tata Nagar and Kolkata. So if TA is visible, what is the chance that it came from Tata Nagar, or what is the chance it came from Kolkata? So all of these are basically talking about a similar type of concept. Guys, we'll close this in another 30 seconds. So if you want to vote, you can do so. Only one person have voted so far. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, there's a confused response. B, C, and D have almost got equal number of votes. But more vote has gone to B, it seems. Okay, let's check. See, if you pick up Krishnagiri, if you pick up Krishnagiri, what is the chance that if you pick up any two consecutive alphabets, it would be RI? So how many consecutive alphabets can be picked up? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay. So out of 10, there are two cases where you end up getting RI. So you can say 2 by 10 is the chance that, given you have picked up Krishnagiri, let's say I call that as event E1, you will get an RI. Okay. Now, Dharmapuri. How many, first of all, two consecutive alphabets can be picked up? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. It's actually 1 less than the total number of letters over here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 10 minus 1 is 9. Out of which only one case is where you'll end up getting RI. So probability that you will see RI given Dharmapuri has been picked up will be 1 by 9. Okay. Now, my question was, what is the probability that if you see RI, it has come from Krishnagiri? So this is what we are looking for. As per our Bayes theorem formula, this is PI into PA by EI by PEI PA by EI plus PE2 into PA by E2. Okay. So PE1 PA by E1 by summation of PEI into PA by EI. So first of all, I always write the denominator term. Half the chance it comes from Krishnagiri. And given that it comes from Krishnagiri, the chance of you having consecutive letters or two consecutive letters as RI is 2 by 5. Or it comes from Dharmapuri and the chance that you get RI as the two consecutive letters is 1 by 9. Okay. Out of this, this term will be there on the numerator. Okay. So your answer will be 1 by 10 divided by 1 by 10, 1 by 10 plus 1 by 18. So that will give you 18 upon 28. 18 upon 28 is 9 upon 14. Option C is correct. Got the point? So those who are just counting the RI, there are two RIs here and that one RI here. So 2 by 3 is the chance. That is not the right way to proceed. Okay. Let's take another one. J 2005 question. Okay, let me put the poll on. Guys, let's wrap this up in one more minute time. Yes, Venkat, you have any questions?
Yes, sir, I'm typing out, sir, because while talking, I'll make it very muddled up.
Okay. Five. 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, most of you have gone with C. Okay, the late problem parts are adding up to 1, so doesn't mean the early problem add. No. Okay, so we will check that out. Okay, so here's a very good question. If you say the probability of him, okay, let me just do this part first. See, what is the question saying? The question is saying that a person goes to office either by car, scooter, bus or train. The probability of which being 1/7. So car is 1/7, scooter is 3/7, bus is 2/7 and train is 1/7. Probability that he reaches office late if he takes car is 2/9. If he takes scooter, 1/9. If he takes bus, 4/9. If he takes train, again, 1/9. Given that he reached office in time, what is the probability that he traveled by car? Okay. So first of all, what do? I first write down the total probability that he is not late. That means he is on time. Correct. When will he not be late? If he had taken a car, and given that he has taken a car, he is not late, which is 7/9. Or he had taken a scooter, which is 3/7. And given that he has taken a scooter, he is not late. That will be 8/9. Or he had taken a bus, 2/7. And given that he had taken a bus, he is not late, 5/9. Or he had taken this. And that given that he has taken a train, he is not late, is 8/9. Out of this, where he had taken car, that is your first expression, this will be on the numerator. So given that he is not late, what is the probability that he had taken a car? It will be 1/7 into 7/9 by the whole thing, which is 1/7 into 7/9, 3/7 into 8/9, 2/7 into 5/9. 1/7 into 8/9. Is that clear? Is that clear?
Okay. Yes, sir.
This answer You can easily calculate by dropping 63 from the denominator. So it's 7 by 7 plus 24 plus 10 plus 8. This will come out to be 7 by 49, which is 1 by 7. Okay. Now, the question is, what is the probability that he used car given he was late? Now, is it 1 minus this? That is what I think is your question, correct?
Yes, sir.
Right. Okay. So if you calculate it, you'll see what is the relationship between these two. Let's try to figure out. So if I write this term P C by L bar, it is P C intersection L bar by P L bar. Correct? Isn't this now P C intersection L bar is what? PC minus PC intersection L. Correct? And L bar is 1 minus PL. Do you think this will simplify to give you this term?
No, sir.
Correct? And we'll also take it through this example. Now, given that he is late, what is the probability that he used a car? So now this answer will be, given that he is late, the probability that he will use a car will be, correct me if I'm wrong, I'm just quickly writing down the expression. That means it will be 2 upon 2 plus 3 plus 8 plus 1. What is this? This is 2 upon 15, I guess. No, sorry, 14. This is also 1 by 7. So they need not add to give you 1. They did not add to give you a 1. That is very much evident from the general formula also. This is not same as 1 minus PC by L.
Oh, sir. So the other part of the probability comes like he took bus and late, bus and early and stuff like that.
Yes. Yes.
Oh, got it, sir.
So many people who have done this, given that he is late, what is the probability that he used a car to come and then you did 1 minus that, you will not get the answer. You will not get the answer. Okay. Let's take this one. So what is the bottom, what is the moral of the story? What is the value?
Don't think like that.
Sir?
Yes, Tirupan.
Sir, if we had to calculate the total probability that he came late, you know, should we just add those four probabilities?
No, you'll have to do taking a car and being late, plus taking a scooter and being late, plus taking a train and being late, taking a bus and being late. You add that. Yes.
Oh, yes. Yes. So that's a denominator.
Now, this is a passage-based question which came in the JEE Advanced Exam 2006. Read this question. I first invite you to solve the 12th one. Yes. Do you want me to run a poll?
1 minute, sir.
Now you can see that they have attached or they have made it directly proportional to I. That means the chance of picking the first turn is not the same as the chance of picking the second turn. Okay, so now this is there's no equal chances of picking up an un. Like we used to do one third, or half half. That is ruled out now. Okay, guys, let's do it because we have to start with binomial probability distribution also. So it'll take a bit of time. So anybody who wants to vote, please do so in the next 10 seconds for the 12th part. Five, four, three, two, one. Okay. Not many people, only five of you have voted. Most of you have voted for B option, B for Bengaluru. Now, let's discuss this. See, first of all, the probability of you picking a urn is directly proportional to I. So let's say I'll call it as KI. But since your UI is a MECE event, we know that summation of PUI should give you a 1, right? That means summation of KI, okay, I will go from 1 to N, should give you a 1. That means K times N into N plus 1 by 2 is equal to 1. So your proportionality constant will be 2 by N, N plus 1, okay? Now, as per our question, we are asked what is the probability of PW, and after that we'll take N tending to infinity. So first let us take that. Can I say this is a quotient of LTP? So the total ways of getting a white ball is the product of the probability of picking the ith urn, and then given that you have picked up an ith urn, getting a white ball from it. Okay. So first of all, ith urn itself will be KI, that is 2I by N into N plus 1. Right? And the chance of you getting a white ball in the ith urn is how much? I by n plus one. So basically you have to do this. Okay. So in short, we have to find summation of 2i square upon n plus 1 square. So this is a constant, only I square will undergo summation process. So I square summation will be n plus 1 into 2n plus 1 by 6. N gone. This will be 2/3. One of this will also go. So it will be n plus 2n plus 1 by 3 times n plus 1. This is your PW. Now they're asking you what is the limit of this as n tends to infinity. So limit of this will be 2/3, because if you divide by n, it will become something like this. So answer is 2/3. Option number B is correct for the first one, second, 12th one. Okay. Next. If PUI is a constant, then what is the probability that you picked up nth urn given you have found a white ball? Given that you have found a white ball, what is the probability that you had got it from the nth urn? Poll is on for 13th one. Okay, Tripan. So 13-1 is a question of Bayes' theorem. Okay, we'll stop in another 15 seconds. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, most of you have gone with option A. Let's check. So if you want to know what is the probability that an N was chosen given you got a white ball, so it is nothing but probability of choosing an number N and getting a white ball from it by total number of ways of getting a white ball. Okay. Now UN, choosing UN itself is a constant. See, the chance that you get a white ball from urn number N is N by N plus 1, because any ith urn will contain I white balls out of total N plus 1 balls. And this will be C into 1 by N plus 1, C into 2 by N plus 1, C into 3 by N plus 1, da 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 da, till C into N by N plus 1. Am I right? Okay, let's do one thing. Let's directly remove the C. Let's directly remove N plus 1, N plus 1, N plus 1, N plus 1. So it is nothing but N by 1 plus 2 plus 3 up till N, which is nothing but N into N plus 1 by 2. N, N gone. Answer is 2 by N plus 1. Okay, so option number A is correct. Janta was absolutely right. Next, 14th question. If N is even and E denotes the event of choosing even numbered urn, what is this? Okay, it is given that P U I is 1 by N, then the value of P getting a white ball given that you had chosen an even number. Okay. This is a conditional probability question. Let's do it. I'll put the poll on for this. This time the chance of picking any urn is fixed, which is 1 by N.
Could you show the question, sir?
This is the question, no? 14th question.
No, sir, the question, that question.
Oh, passage, yeah.
Yes, sir.
Guys, let's finish this. We have less half an hour only to discuss probability distribution function. I'll give you another 15 seconds to wrap this up. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay. So we have to find out what is the probability of getting a white ball from an even numbered urn. From an even numbered urn, most of you have gone with B option. Chalo, we'll check. See. Oh, where should I write? Yeah. So probability of you getting a white ball from an even numbered urn is nothing but probability of white ball from an even numbered urn by probability of choosing an even number, right? So you getting a white ball from an even numbered urn, you have to start with the second urn. The chances of you getting a white ball from there is this. And you choosing fourth urn, and the chances of you getting a white ball from there will be 4 by n plus 1. Correct? And this will go till 1 by n into n by n plus 1. Okay? Am I right?
N is even, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, n is even. Okay? Divided by the total ways of getting even, which is 1 by n, 1 by n, 1 by n, this will be written n by 2 times. Correct? No? Okay. So what do you get from here? You get, we can take, I think, 2 by n, n plus 1 common. So 2 by n, n plus 1 common. And on the numerator, you'll get 1 plus 2 plus 3 all the way till n by 2. And denominator is n by 2 times 1 by n. Okay. N gone, this will go up. So it will become 4 by n, n plus 1. And this will become n by 2 plus 1 by 2. How much does it simplify to? So first of all, n, 4, 4 gone. This will become n plus 2 by 2 n plus 1. Is there any option which says like this, n plus 2 by 2, n plus 1? N plus 2 by 2, n plus 1. Yes, option number B says so. Is this fine? Any questions, any concerns? Okay, so okay, so now we are going to talk about PDFs, probability distribution functions. Probability distribution functions. Okay. Now, before I start talking about it, I would like to talk about something called random discrete variable. A random discrete variable. Okay. There is something called random continuous variable, but that will be studied under the concept of Z distribution, which is also called normal distribution. That's another type of function, which is called normal distribution function. We'll talk about that in your engineering. Your professor will talk about it. Sir, you will be only taking our engineering classes also. By the way, I can teach till first year, but not beyond that. First year ke baad maths is all about, you know, abstract thing, linear algebra and all will come into picture. Anyways, what's a random discrete variable? In order to explain this, I'll give you a simple example. Let us say you have three coins. You have three coins. Okay. Or let's say you have one coin, you're tossing it three times. That's another way to look at it. So you have a coin, you have a coin which you are tossing three times. Okay. If I ask you, what is the probability of getting heads on these three tosses? Mind you, my question is just saying, what is the probability of getting heads when you are tossing three times? I never said how many heads, right? So your number of heads here will be your random discrete variable, because it is coming from a random experiment. Discrete because it can take discrete values, like you can get 0 head, 1 head, 2 head, 3 head. Variable because it is variable, because you can get either 0, 1, 2 or 3. Okay, so that would be called a random discrete variable. So let's say if I say, what is the probability of getting heads? Okay, when you toss a coin, so how many heads? That is a random discrete variable because it can be 1, 2 or 3 in number. Okay, so if you write down a table where you are listing the probability of getting 0 head, 1 head, 2 head or 3 head, such a table will be called as a probability distribution table. Okay, correct. So we all know that if you're tossing a coin three times, the probability of getting 0 head is 1/8, because out of 8 outcomes, one of them will be when you have no head at all. So tail. 1 head will be 3/8, 2 head will also be 3/8, and 3 head will be 1/8, right? So when you write such a table, you are basically writing the probability distribution table. Ab yahan aap puchoge ki, you talked about function. Where is function here? Okay, so if you write the same as a form of a formula, which I am going to write down in front of you right now. So the probability of you getting x heads is 3cx half to the power of x half to the power of 3 minus x. So if you put x as 0, you will end up getting 1/8. You can check it out. Now, from where do I get this formula? That is something which I will tell you later on. So as of now, this is a probability distribution function. So this will be your PDF. Okay. Anyways, we'll come to it later on. As of now, just understand what is a random discrete variable. Okay. And when we write such a table, we call it as a probability distribution table. Okay. Now, few things that you must know about this table. So why do we need this table? What are the inferences we can draw from this table? I'll tell you in some time. So let us try to understand before that something called Bernoulli's trial. If you are performing an experiment whose outcome can be written as a success or a failure. So any trial whose outcome can be considered to be a success or a failure. Now, when I say failure and success, do not take it in a literal sense. It just means something and something complementary of it. For example, you tossing a coin is a Bernoulli trial, because either you get a head or you don't get a head. So if you consider head to be a success, so either you get a success or you don't. Correct? Let's say a ship is trying to reach from the source to destination. So ship reaching is a success if you are calling it by that, and not reaching it is a failure. There's nothing positive or negative attached to it. Don't think like, oh, reached, it is success. Good thing, no, success. Bad thing means fail. No. For an enemy, the ship not reaching is a success. So it depends on the question. What are you calling as a success? What are you calling as a failure? Please do not attach any literal emotional feeling to that particular success and the failure, right? So let's say it raining today is a failure for us and a success for the farmers, right? So it depends upon with respect to what you are solving the question, that is success or a failure. In short, basically, I want to say anything which results into the event happening or the event not happening is a Bernoulli's trial. Okay. Now, if a Bernoulli trial is performed independently n times, then we basically use binomial probability distribution for such cases. So let me give you an example. You tossing a coin three times. You tossing a coin three times. This is actually a Bernoulli trial because a coin can give you either head or no head. So if let's say I say, write down the probability distribution of the number of heads that you get on tossing of this coin, which is basically the same example which I gave you. Now, this is a question where you getting a head is a, let's say, success, which I call as P, and you getting a tail is a failure, which I call as Q normally. So failure is 1 minus success, correct? Now, you want to write down the probability distribution of the number of heads that you get. So what do we do in such cases? We use binomial theorem, and that is why that is called a binomial distribution function. Now, how do we use binomial theorem? All of you please understand here. So what is the chance that you will get, let me just remove this first. What is the chance that you will get no success at all? What is the chance that you get no success at all? So when you don't get a success means every time you are tossing, you are getting tail, 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 isn't it? Yes or no? Correct? So read this as if you have written cube, right? Correct? If I ask you what is the chance you get one head, then this one head can come in three ways. Either the first throw gives you head and the other throws do not give you head, or the first gives you tail, second gives you head, third doesn't give you, or first doesn't give you, second doesn't give you, third gives you, right? So if you see here, you are basically writing 1 by 2 whole cube 3 times. Indirectly, you are writing 3C1. One success you want, or you can say 2 failures and 1 success. So this term that you have written is actually read as this. This term that you have written is actually read as this. Okay, so 1 success, 2 failures, and that success can be positioned in 3 ways in those independent trials. So 3C1 Q square P to the power 1. Similarly, if you want 2 successes, again, it can be done in 3C2 Q into P square. If you want 3 successes, it is 3C3 Q to the power 0, P to the power 3. And just to make things rhyme up over here, this will be 3C1 P to the power 0, 3C1 Q to the power 3, P to the power 0. If you see these three terms, it would remind you as if you are writing you're writing binomial theorem for this expansion, isn't it? So if you expand it, don't you get 3C0 this, which is your first term over here? You get 3C1 Q square P, which is your second term here. You get 3C2 Q P square, which is your third term here. And you get 3C3 Q0 P cube, which is your fourth term here. Okay. So since this probability distribution can be written by the use of binomial theorem, we call them as binomial probability distribution. So when Bernoulli trials are performed independently, okay, we use binomial probability distribution. Are you getting my point? Let's take a simple example of this. Of course, this is one of the examples which I have taken. But before that, I would try to generalize this. So binomial probability distribution function is basically nothing but if you are performing a Bernoulli trial where chances of success is Q, chances of success is P, and chances of failure is Q, then let's say X is the number of successes you get, then according to Bernoulli trial, it is basically the expansion of this term. So it will be NC0 Q to the power N P to the power 0, NC1 Q to the power N minus 1 P to the power 1. Next term also I will write NC2 Q to the power N minus 2 P square da 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 till NCN Q to the power 0 P to the power N. Is this fine? By the way, whenever you are using binomial theorem for this, which of course you have to use, always write the failure first and then the success. So this is failure, success, and this is the number of trials you're taking. Is it fine? Okay. Let's take a small question on the same. Okay, let's take this one. The probability that a student is not a swimmer is 1/5. Find the probability that out of four students, out of five students, four are swimmers. Five students, four are swimmers. Okay. Now, let's say I do this problem in a more elaborative way. Let's say if I say, what is the probability of you choosing a person which is swimmer? Okay. Now, I did not mention how many swimmer. So, out of five people, what is the probability of you choosing swimmers? So, if you write a table out of it, this is how you will write. So, first of all, the X values can range from 1 to 5 because there are 5 people. Either you can get no swimmer, 1 swimmer, 2 swimmer, 3 swimmer, 4 swimmer or 5 swimmer. Correct? Okay. Now, in order to fill this, I will make use of binomial theorem. So, you getting a swimmer is a success over here. Okay. And you not getting a swimmer is a failure. So, failure you write first. Okay. So failure is 1/5, that is Q. You getting a swimmer is this, okay? And how many trials are you taking? There are five people out of it, so five trials you are taking, okay? So when you write this in a binomial form, you will end up getting the first term as 5C0, 1/5 to the power of 5 into 4 by 5 to the power 0. You don't have to write 5C0 and 4 by 5 to the power 0. It is just 1/5 to the power 5. That means you end up getting no swimmers in that. Okay. Now, one means one success. So you want one swimmer to be selected. So that will be this. If you want two swimmers to be selected, 5C2, this. Three swimmers, 5C3, this. Four swimmers, this, and five swimmers, 5C5, 1 by 5 to the power 0, 4 by 5 to the power 5. Okay. Now, what is the question asking you? The question is asking you, what is the probability that out of five students, four are swimmers? So basically, they're asking, what is P4? Okay. So right now, you wrote for everything. It's like you picked up the entire Himalaya as a Hanuman when you were not able to find out that Sanjeevani Jadi Bhuti. But now they're asking you just one of the features. So this is the one they are asking you. So answer is 5C4, 1/5 into 4/5 to the power 4. Clearly option number A is correct. Are you getting my point? So several types of questions can be framed. For example, I may ask you, what is the probability that you get at least four swimmers? then you have to add 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, sorry. You have to add 4 and 5. My bad. 4 and 5. At least 4 swimmers. Okay. At most 4 swimmers, then you have to add 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Correct? Now, a few things that you would all notice over here is that these all terms, if you add, you are actually writing the sum of all these terms is actually this term. And this term is clearly a 1. So, few observations that you can have. I will write here itself. So, important points to be noted. The summation of your PXI will always be 1. Always. Okay. So, in any probability distribution, whether it is binomial or non-binomial, the sum of probability should always be 1. Right? Second thing that you need to know is something called the expected value of X. Many people call it as mean value of X. That means, if at all you are picking up 5 students, what is the chance that in those, what is the chance of getting a swimmer in those 5 students? Or what is the average number of swimmers you will end up picking if you pick up 5 students? Are you getting my point? For example, let's say I'm tossing a coin 3 times. 3 times I'm tossing a coin. What is the average number of heads I will get? Now, common sense says 3 by 2 heads, right? 50-50 chance is head and a tail, right? So, out of 3 times, 1.5 heads I'll get, 1.5 tails. Even though theoretically it is not possible. Practically it is not possible. But this is the theoretical way of looking at it. Okay, that is called the expected value. That value, this formula is actually given by the same formula that you had learned in your mean statistics. That is summation xi, or you can say summation fi into xi by summation fi, correct? Right? Now here the name is slightly getting changed. Here you can write f1 x1 by total number, f2 x2 by total number, and so on. Okay, this is fn xn by total number. This term is actually the probability of occurrence of x1. So you write it as px1 into x1. This is px2. px2 into x2, and so on. So in short, the formula for getting the expected number of successes when you perform the experiment n times, expected number of successes when you perform the experiment n times is summation pxi into xi, I from 1 to n. Okay. So let's apply this to our coin question. So let's say I'm tossing a coin 3 times. What is the expected number of heads I will get? So I will use the data which I had already written in the first slide. Okay. So your expected number of heads will be 0 into 1 by 8, 1 into 3 by 8, 2 into 3 by 8, plus again 3 into 1 by 8. If you sum this up, you will end up getting 3 plus 6. How much is this? 3 plus 6, 9. 9 plus 6 is 12. 12 by 8. 12 by 8 is 1.5. Didn't we guess that? Didn't we guess that? Out of 3 times, 50% or 1.5 heads you will get. Okay. Even though practically it is not possible, but this gives you a rough idea about how many successes you will get. And the third thing that you need to know is the how scattered is your successes, or what is the variance of the success. So this is given by a summation of pxi into xi minus x bar, which is your expected value, whole square. Okay. Let me take this in the other page. Anybody who wants to note this down, please note it.
Yes, sir. One second.
Yes, sir.
Sir, in this previous question that you did, the swimmer question.
Yeah.
So there the swimmers are like distinct, no sir, not identical swimmers.
Yeah, distinct swimmers, yes.
So if we have like five identical balls, and then we say that some, so if we have identical things,
identical things, you will not be able to apply this 5C1, 5C2, etc.
Okay.
In that case, events, the process will change. This will not be the process.
Okay, sir. And sir, if we have more than two outcomes possible, then can we use multinomial theorem also?
That's a very good question to ask. You can use multinomial theorem.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. So variance, I'll talk about variance of X in, so variance of X is defined as summation of PXI into X minus X bar the whole square. Remember, X bar is your expected value of X. Okay. See, this is very similar to the definition that you followed for variance in a statistics also, isn't it? Do you remember you used to write Fi into Xi minus X bar whole square by summation Fi? The same thing I have written over here in the language of probability. So if you expand this, I'll just show you something very interesting here. If you expand it, you get X bar minus 2 X bar X plus X bar square. So this will give you X square, or you can say you can say summation PXI into XI square minus 2 X bar summation PXI into XI. And here you get X bar square times summation PXI. This term, let it be as it is. This term that you see is back to X bar, isn't it? So it is X bar bar. And this term is 1. We have already seen that the sum of the probabilities will be 1. So if you simplify it, one of them will get cancelled over here with this. So it will give you summation of PXI into XI square minus expected value square. So you can also write it as summation PXI XI square minus expected value square. Okay. Now, for special case of binomial distribution, so for a binomial distribution, the expected value of the success is always NP. Variance is NPQ. Now, how? I'll just take 1 minute for you to prove expected value is NP. The rest you can prove it as a homework. So when you write a binomial distribution, this is NC0, Q to the power N, P to the power 0. NC1, Q to the power N minus 1, P to the power 1. NC2, Q to the power N minus 2, P square. NCN, Q to the power 0, P to the power N, right? So as per the definition of expected value, the definition is summation PXI into XI, correct? So if you do 0 into this, that will be 0. So you can say, just to write less, I'll say 0 into C0, and I'm not writing it. Q to the power N, P to the power 0. Then you have 1 into C1, Q to the power N minus 1, P. Then 2 into C2, Q to the power N minus 2, P square, and so on till N into CN, Q to the power 0, P to the power N. Okay. Now, all of you, please pay attention. I will take Q to the power N common, so it will be 0 C0 P by Q to the power of 0. This will be 1 C1 P by Q to the power of 1. Then 2 C2 P by Q square da 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 till N into NCN P by Q to the power N Okay, so we want to find this. Now just look at this. This will remind you of C0, C1x, 2C2x square, dot, 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 till ncn x to the power n, isn't it? Where x is your p by q, correct? Now, what is the way to find this? Now, go back to your childhood days when we did the binomial theorem. In binomial theorem, we learned that in order to find this, we can use our calculus method. So let me just write it. Just allow me 5 more minutes time. आप लोगों से निवेदन है कि आप 5 मिनट एक्स्ट्रा दें मुझे. ओके, राइट. सो फर्स्ट मल्टीप्लाई इट विथ अ एक्स. बाय द वे, यू डोंट वांट C0 टू अकर, राइट? सो इट इज 0 C0, सो डोंट वरी. सो जस्ट डिफरेंशिएट इट विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू एक्स. सो दिस विल बी एन 1 प्लस एक्स टू द पावर एन माइनस 1. C0 विल गो फॉर अ टॉस. यू विल गेट C1, यू विल गेट 2C2x, you will get 3C3x square all the way till ncn x to the power n minus 1, right? But we need an x square here. So we'll multiply again with an x. So just multiply an x. So furnish one x to it. Okay. That means this term that you have written can be written as, so back to this term again, q to the power n. Now n x 1 plus x to the power n minus 1. Am I right? Okay, let's try to simplify this. So here, if you take an LCM inside the bracket, it will become p plus q to the power n minus 1 by q n minus 1. This will be p by q. This is n and this is q to the power n. This will get cancelled. P plus Q is known to be 1. So answer will be NP into 1 to the power N minus 1, which is NP. So you don't have to directly apply this formula. Even this is a universal formula. This is used for any distribution, universal formula. But if you are using a binomial distribution, you can directly use this formula to save your time. Okay. And variance is special. Variance also, please try to prove this. Variance, please try to prove that this expression gives you under NPQ. Please prove this as a homework. Same approach, not different. Okay. I would like to take one more question on this before we wrap today's session. Posons I will be discussing when I'm doing a crash course. Don't worry, that is not that important, because that will take another half an hour easily. Okay, let's take this question. X is a random variable with distribution given below. Okay. What is the value of k and what is the variance of this experiment, or what is the variance of the random discrete variable? Okay, done. So this is K is what? K can be obtained by using the fact that this will be 1. So it is very obvious that 8K is 1. So K is 1 by 8. Okay. So this is 1 by 8, 3 by 8, 3 by 8, 1 by 8. Very much like that coin thing question. Yeah. So what is the variance of the data? Variance of the data, as we had already discussed, it is summation of PXI into XI square minus expected value square. Okay. Now, first of all, we need to find out the expected value. Expected value is summation PXI into XI. Okay. You can directly find it by the original formula, but original formula is slightly difficult to apply. This is more convenient to apply. So this is 0 into 1/8, 1 into 3/8, 2 into 3/8, plus 3 into 1/8, which we had already figured out was coming out to be 1 by 3 by 2, right? So now this will become 0 into k square, which is 0, 1 into 1 square into 3 by 8. So I'm applying this thing first. Then 2 square into 3 by 8. And then 3 square into again 1 by 8. Okay. Minus 3 by 2 square. Let's see how much it comes out to be. So 3 by 8, 12 by 8. Again 9 by 8. Minus 18 by 8. So how much is this? How much does it come out to be?
3 by 4, sir.
3 by 2?
4.
3 by 4?
Yes, sir.
Option number D is correct. Is the idea clear how it works? Okay. So with this, we close our session here. Thank you so much. It was a pleasure teaching you all. We'll again meet tomorrow with a crash course on trigonometry. It'll run for 2 days, Monday and Tuesday. Take care. Bye-bye. Have a good day. Yes, sir.